10 seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining.
Alrighty. Hello, everyone, and welcome back to our second game of the day here. The two open qualifier squads, some new up-and-comers, young upstarts, amateur Dota 2, Fantastic Five versus Secret. I'm MopMax. I'm joined by PKMZ. How you doing? Yep.
10 seconds.
The scrub Dota.
Team Secrets turn to ban.
RTZZI. That's his name, RTZI. Should be good.
10 seconds remaining.
I mean, he doesn't need any help. Remaining.
Dire team ban.
Well, when I talked to, back when I first started getting more of the competitive scene and I actually started getting to talk to pro players for the first time and everything, everyone, like, literally cabins of their to be like, yeah, we based our entire play around where TZ plays Dota. Like, that's literally what I was told by captains of teams, of professional teams. I'm like, holy shit. Like, I guess they, like, seriously respect the way this guy plays fucking Dota. Like, the way his map movements and everything were, this is, like, 2 years ago kind of idea, right? Yeah, and like, that was how the game started. Yeah.
5 seconds remaining.
Dark Seer.
Dire team pick.
Yeah, 10 seconds
remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time.
Well, I'm sure he'll get back there. I have faith. I believe, but
Beastman.
Team Secrets turn to pick.
Yeah, it kind of depends on what heroes they get. Like sometimes, from the most part, what I've seen, it seems to be Envy going mid on like Death Prophet, but other heroes it still be RTZ.
10 seconds remaining.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah.
5 seconds remaining.
Well, I would expect more of it in the future, to be honest, right? Like, I could see that still happening.
Dire team battle.
But either way. The one thing they won't be getting this game will be that puppy Elder Titan, something that they just had like every single game during the open qualifiers. They just like, if it got, you know, let through, they were taking it first overall, so, and then the other one being, of course, the Terror Blade for Envy, something they're also not afraid to take up in that first phase. But the Timbersaw is the other hero that they have played nonstop for RTZ. He played in his last, what, 5 games here? Took up Timbersaw in his last 6-7 games times. He's rocking a lot of Timbersaw lately. Solid hero.
Team Secrets turn to ban.
No, yeah.
Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining.
Well, it's interesting you mentioned like meta and everything, because we're looking and the big 2-3 openers both being ignored completely. Yeah, Phoenix Void and then Ricky Daxia. I mean, yeah, there could have been Ricky Lifesteer.
Five seconds remaining.
Yeah.
Reserve time.
Well, yeah, I think the decks here just kind of being that nice, like, one opener and then coming back into your fourth pick is maybe a little more stable. You get to see your opener and see how Timbersaw is going to react to that. So, Beastmaster definitely solid against Timber in some ways just because he can help with that mana burn a little bit, but definitely not as disastrous as a lot of other, like, mid heroes when they get roared up or something. Only one single point of control, and Timbersaw can still sometimes slip himself away with a Timber Chain there with that reactive armor helping him tank up. But the fact that, like, Ricky Lifestealer, pretty spooky. I don't know. If I'm Fantastic Five, possibly considering going to the Lifestealer here, even though it's not a hero they've been 5 picking up too much themselves, they're much more about, like, that Chaos Knight kind of stuff, or some bigger hard carries, and the Terrorblade, the Spectre, the Morphling, the Luna. These are the kind of stuff that they're running lately, so I don't know if that really fits their pace. Well, with Darkseer, I mean, yeah, that's kind of how I feel about it. Like, you already have the IO. You get a nice combo in the mid lane
10
too. Get a lot
seconds
of that synergy
remaining.
going. Yeah, definitely solid tanker ban.
5 seconds.
Shadow Demon.
Yeah.
Team Secrets turn to pick. Ten seconds remaining.
Yeah.
5 seconds
Yeah.
remaining.
We see a lot of that whole, like, IO just roaming top, mid, over and
Reserve.
over, controlling that bounty rune in between, or, well, any rune in between, just making sure that those lanes do go well for them. So, next it comes up with that Shadow Demon. This is just something that's definitely popping up quite a bit more, right? Everyone just making these illusions, using that new time, decent saving hero in comparison to, like, your Oracle and and everything like that, another defense hero, and then the purge just in case that Lifestealer comes out. Seem to do pretty well against that too.
Dire team pick.
They
5 seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time.
Yeah, I think you're right. They're probably looking towards. I know they've done the Luna in the past with it, where you do, like, the illusions. And then the other one that I think would be more stable would be, like, Axe, but they already have the Beastmasters. So then you're getting into, like, this four roll Axe or something. Or, well, in this case, it'd have to be, like, a position one Axe, and that's just a little bit too complexity for a lot of teams, you know? That intense. I get concerned every time I see up the Axe. I'm still not sold on that hero, but they make it work.
Ten seconds remaining. Lina. Team Secrets turn to pick.
I mean, this is a Shadow Demon Lina. Like, what is this? But yeah, I assume so. Lane.
Ten seconds remaining.
Yeah.
Five
Did
seconds
you
remaining.
catch the NA games at all last night with the MJW offlane
Reserve
Lina?
time.
Iron Talon first. Because, like, honestly, the sad part is, though, considering, like, well, yeah, well, we hit a Tidehunter last game, right? Who it's an offlane hero, but he just bought an Iron Talon and went to the jungle. So theoretically, at this point in the game, if any hero can just buy an Iron Talon and jungle, I'm surprised more teams aren't experimenting into something oh yeah, it worked. It actually worked, like, unbelievably well. He just, like, got farmed in the jungle, came out, made some plays at level 6. No, I think it was pretty sure it was against complexity, wasn't it?
Weaver.
Dire team ban.
Well, hey. And hey, Dota, what can I say? I mean, you know, you had the Beast of Safe Lane, Faceless Void. Helped her out a little bit, turning into those setups, but it was something else. It was, certainly, food for thought there. Yeah. Well, there's the Axe Ban. Be, taken up by Fantastic Five here. Don't have to tangle with the Puppy Axe, something he's running a little bit lately. Well, the other big one that's left would be the Enchantress and the Enigma. Those are the only like really big ones he's been playing a lot lately, other than the Keeper of the Light, which also, honestly, it does well with the Timber Saw, but you don't have that same Terror Blade for like moving around the map that they like to pair it up with. Like, I don't think it's that good with just Weaver. Oh, wow, look at that. I mean, that's not on me. Who bans Caudle in the second phase?
5 seconds remaining. Reserve time.
Oh wait, can't they just Ricky? I know they don't value Ricky on Team Secret, but this seems like a really good Ricky Darksteer game.
Ten seconds remaining. Five.
Night Stalker.
Dire team.
Okay, yeah, same idea.
Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining.
Yeah, and a lot of it going to be relying, it kind of looks like, as to where Puppy can, like, maneuver himself around, right? And, like, who he silences up first between someone like the Shadow Demon, the Lina, or the Io. And, well, the Luna gets banned out. That'll be the Illidan Medusa to partner up here with our Shadow Demon.
Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining.
I find, personally find Medusa apps very hard to judge a lot of the time. Like, it's just one of those heroes that, it seems like it kind of depends on your own lineup. I mean, I'm looking at Team Secret, I'm like, how are they going to deal with, like, the mana shield? And any sort of mana burn going? I don't really have a good sense myself as a how tanky. I guess I need to play more Medusa. Yeah, Lion, of course, is nice for that mana drain.
And
not the most traditional
hero as well. Like, I would say Medusa has to buy BKB this game, which is not a very Medusa item. I don't know, like, it's really hard for her, I feel like, because she doesn't have a lot of ability to be active. Io is probably the main reason the hero is really strong this game, because it's so much extra sustain. If you can actually manage to play a 4 position Io, get Guardian Greaves off, you literally don't health pull, which is insane. And then suddenly Secret's amount of damage doesn't matter that much when you effectively have 2 lives with an Io. And heaven forbid you get an Aegis, right? There's a lot of ways to make it work. I'm just really scared that if it doesn't work, their plan B is really, really bad.
Yeah, that is true, I guess. Like, arcane boots and everything to double everything from, like, Io could make Illidan, like, just suddenly unkillable in a fight if the right circumstances to occur.
Yeah, and I can see that's why they went for it. Like, it's a lot of sense on their own draft. It's just looking at it from an outside perspective. And from a drafting perspective in my past, it's like, having a plan B and C, really, like, puppy-style drafting from tier 2 team drafting, where they have multiple ways of winning games, they have multiple outs if things go wrong. I'm not saying Secret's straight up better or it's amazing or anything, not anything revolutionary, I'm just saying it's more solid overall. Like, if things go wrong for the ITZ, they've got ways of either making it right or it not mattering that much, because Eternal Envy can play very aggressive, or Bob got a lot of space on his Darkseid to pressure the lane. They've just got multiple avenues, I feel like.
Speaking of which, it's a slight introductions here. Even though none of these heroes really need introductions, I guess we should make these new open qualifier teams more relatable, right? So yeah, they have a chance to get the public's eye. You know, when is the next time these guys are ever going to be in the spotlight? So it's going to be Pai Lai Dai on the Lion down here. Going to be supporting up here Poopy on your Night Stalker. Eterna Lenvi on the Weaver, or Teezeye, going to be on this Timbersaw, and then Bulbul on the Darkseer. So just some new upstarts here. Really happy to see them win that qualifier.
Yeah, and for the other side, which might be slightly more well-known, we all on the Shadow Demon, 63 aka Perfect on the Lina, which I'm happy to see him on. He's really, really hero. RMN on the Io, Illidan, Stormage on the Busa, I haven't really seen too much of him play offlane either. I've seen one or two games for them, but when he used to play carry for Vega, he always used to prefer, like, the more space-creating hero, so I imagine this role. Oh.
Yeah, I would agree with that, too. BZZ, I don't get to watch a lot of Fantastic Five. I never find myself casting them, but I have a kind of somewhat comical relationship, I guess, with BZZ, where I help do these, like, little voiceovers for Russian videos that he does. He does a lot of guides in Russia. And so my role is, like, I take this, like, broken English translation and turn it into something readable for English people. And the guy is just, like, holy shit, he's smart at Dota. Like, I just read all the stuff that he talks about and everything, and just, like, the understanding that he has of all these different mid-matchups. You can give him anything, and he can give you, like, the entire breakdown of it. So I really like to see him bringing in this kind of hero like Lina. I think he just has a really good idea of how to deal with, like, this Timbersaw in a way that we haven't seen, considering how popular the hero's been.
Yeah, he's also got one of the other very, very strong Lina players on his team, so I imagine there's a lot of back and forth and a lot of ideas going around. I don't think Lina's, like, amazing against Timber in the lane, purely from you have to do a lot of right clicks to dominate the lane with Lina. That's half the point of the hero. Sure, you have the nuke, but you get level 6, kill potential really isn't there. So I think the laning stage isn't the
Yeah, gotta get that Laguna not, Blade going, you know?
Yeah, it's not bad laning stage by any means. I expect it to be fairly 50. I think RTZ is a better mid player, but there isn't really too much to read into this matchup, I feel like.
Yeah, so far so good. We'll see how much more help ends up coming to the mid. The other lanes are just quiet, right? I mean, Bulba's up here doing
iron
shell
really
things.
This is really weird, though. To see them pressure the tower this early puts a lot of intent. And I think it's a really good start, because A, it forces the Darkseid to come up. Shouldn't. Or they're giving away a free tier 1 tower at a point in the game where it actually matters. You get 200, 300 gold around the 5-minute mark.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Yeah, that's the point of the game where that gold actually matters. The a null and void tower. The only thing it really does is secure the hard camp by the sideshow. That's the only reason this tower's full valued. If you can, as I am off to a good dart, give him an influx of gold, then the draft looks like it can work a lot easier for all.
Yeah, it's actually crazy what difference it makes. It like 5 minutes versus 10 minutes when you think about things like your mid hero. I mean, certain matches like bottle coming or maybe like phase boots for certain heroes, and of course your offlaner with a new iron talent could like totally change their life if they can just get brown boots out of nowhere. It could be good, and they did pass the halfway mark here, so see if Bulba can actually prevent it from going down. He's moving into the Soul Ring, he's got the gold for it now thanks to going for this iron talent first build, something that kind of pioneered at least by Bulba, it seems to be the guy who I see it the most personally, at least, where he just like straight up none of this like going to lane business, that's done, we're over that, like just getting this Darkseer iron talent. I feel like he was one of those heroes that people were still like, nah, you still go Soul Ring and you try out the lane and But everyone just started ganking level 1 Darkseers. Like, every single time, I'd see Darkseers come up top of their Iron Shell, and they try and play by the wave, and, like, offlaner just, like, starts in the safe lane and TP the offlane, because they know it's a free kill.
I can't say I've seen it to that extent, but yeah, the amount of, like, pressure people put on Darkseer level 1 is very warranted, because if Terra doesn't get level 2, you can kill him. If he does get level 2 for a lot of drafts, like this one included, kill avenue is very, very strong. I'm a big fan of this, starting in the jungle and then coming up to the offlane where you can actually pressure it. Level 1 Iron Shell, difference to level 3 and level
5. It really is.
Or level 2 and 3, depending how you look. You know what I mean.
Oh, look at this. They're already bringing Puppy in here. He's also level 3, just all that space down bottom, you know, they're just manipulating the waves and everything. Level 3 on Pilot Eye as well.
They stole that smoke.
Sick.
Oh yeah, nice. It's coming.
We're there. Question is, I guess, if they properly predict where it's going, and to the rune would be the most likely spot, so Yul will pay for it. I think he got the deny, right?
Yeah, he denied the rune. Yeah. It's not the biggest earth rotation, but this is going to stem into... now. Nighttime
building
hit,
got the
puppies.
Tower.
Yeah, it's now that he's going to be forced out of his lane a lot, and there's going to be a lot of rotations to protect him. Free IO, you know?
Yeah.
That shouldn't happen, though. That's... bad.
Yeah, a little bit sloppy there. Well, considering how, like, I mean, they even had, like, the ward down, they knew this whole rotation was coming in the first place from the smoke, Yul died at the rune, maybe just an extra one for free there, as, we also have our Beastmaster drop down in the jungle there. Just doing his thing.
I don't think Yul dying was too bad, because the whole pilot eye thing, right, you tank the smoke for your carry, but now that the pressure's gonna come to your safe lane if he died or not, I'd much rather he died than the deuce. Or the boss dead the lane, etc.
Wow.
IO also dying there was just for free, and kind of setting the pace of the game now, and where Secret can really start approaching on the Doosa and stopping her getting to the point she needs to get to. Lina and... they're having very good games, but they're not online yet. You know, Lina kind of wants at least phase boots or some movement items in level 6. Okay, she's got levels, but... you know, without Beastmaster as well, I feel they're not quite in fighting shape yet.
Pilot Eye will just be able to break up any attempt here mid. Get the disruption off here, so... changes to that, that was the big... the duration. Oh, is it actually not listed? Oh, there it is. The duration goes up to 14 seconds. And we talked a little bit about those comps earlier, but it's pretty ridiculous. Like, we've seen the Centaur War Runner, of course, was kind of the first one by Alliance that had people paying attention to kind of the comedy of it, but just back into all these hard carries too. Some rather decent siege potential.
The issue's getting there, though, because, like, he's level 1 at the moment, and... criminal. Like, okay, the tomb helps a lot. He's
6 minutes in.
The, like, level-reliant hero, in terms of, you know, getting your ult makes a hero, but the big problem is... you can't do anything with this hero when you don't have boot. You're like... you have to be the one initiating for Lina most of the time, or you're playing super defensive and waiting to counter-initiate. You're just free food when people run at you at this stage.
Yeah.
I'm surprised he's not the one pulling, being super greedy. The IO's doing that instead, but... I feel like this is going to be a huge problem for them, because he's going to play a big part in this game. Being level 1 is not good.
Wow, four so heroes bottoms, they die, Pasha. And, one TP gets cancelled and so does the second, I mean... that was just a dead hero, so... Gank Squad is real. These three heroes, eh? Lion, Nightstalker, Bulba being there in the Darkseer, just throwing out some Iron Shells and applying this pressure, putting up the three kills to zero, and... the only real downside, I suppose, just being that they haven't quite gotten onto that Medusa quite yet, right? But...
they tried, they did for like a minute though, but... they value the kills, getting their own farm at this point, well, if not more than shutting down Doosa. Like, if you look at how Envy's built, very like
is...
dominant heavy. You don't
Pasha's
normally see
just like, oh, that seemed like a really obvious play that was coming in here. Okay, no, he ends up living, so I thought he was gonna die. But this is I mean, I guess I can understand this is like Nightstalker's been playing over here. Bulba was like down here, but he ends up surviving.
Cost of the tier one though.
Yeah.
Now it kinda evens up a bit, and I feel like any bit of farm that Envy gets with the items he's gone, he's it's not going to be super tanky, but if you can skirt around the edge of the fights and TP in after the initial barrage of spells have been used, you're going to have a free run in them. And Weaver's an amazing hero at getting onto Shadow Demon and Io. To some extent, Lina as well in fights. It very much depends on items and kind of where you are in the game as to how that mashup works. But for the supports, it's going to be a nightmare for them. Dealing with Kimbasaur, which is already super mobile, tanky hero that you can't really shut down. Weaver's just super mobile and does a lot of damage. So there's another reason I don't like that Yol was pretty much left to fend for like himself. Now he's at least getting the mid lane, taking some stacks, but
looks like we're gonna go for a roar kill on Envy down bottom, and maybe an unfortunate time to come and be aggressive here, as PZZ shows up and Envy's just instantly annihilated there. So a little unfortunate, feeling safe thanks to all the vision that they did have there up in the lane, and now with the rotation coming down from the IO as well, just bringing him right into the proper spot to make sure that won't go wrong. Just you know, a short little relocate, it's fine. Turns into a nice
kill
little double
kill.
Yeah,
you know, doesn't matter if it's the other side of the map or 10 feet away from you. Now they're finally at a point where they've got the roar, they've got the items they need. So this is their kind of counterplay, especially as it's daytime as well. Puppy doesn't really want to be proactive at this stage. I think he wants to be farming up more than, you know, getting in people's faces. Obviously, if Fantastic Five comes to him, he's happy to fight, but good that they're the ones putting the aggression on now it's daytime.
Yeah, and his build. Okay, yeah, so he's gone for the max Timber Chain. I mean, being up against the range here on the mid lane, pretty important. Wow, nice little harasser on VZZ as he cuts through, but very important for the counter initiation plays, right? So that, like, he can actually fight at a tower. He's not in this melee matchup mid where you have, like, four willing deaths and no Timber Chains that we've been seeing a bit of, honestly. And then suddenly, like, your carry's being dove and you can't do shit. This is gonna be a much more aggressive build.
I think even against melee heroes, two and whirling death is the way to go, because Timber Chain is how you play the hero outside of the lane.
Yeah, that's the thing. I'm not sold on the four whirling death either myself. Even the four reactive armor too, I feel like some people may be getting a little bit overhyped on that. Just become this useless no damage dealer.
Yeah, like, as an offlane it's complete viable, but as a mid lane, you need Timber Chain. It's how the hero works. If you're gonna sit mid like Arteezy's done this game, and you can't pressure Lina without Timber Chain, so you might as well do it anyway, but the second you rotate him away to help with fights, he's not gonna be that useful. This game is just not the most amount of setup if you don't have Timber Chain. He has to be the one to get his own damage out. He doesn't have setup to, you know, he's got Pylodos Lion, but I suppose with Surge you can make it work. Yeah, this is just so easier to play. Relying on your teammates all the time is not good. And I'm not saying that as in they can't execute, I'm saying like you don't want to have to force them to, you know, babysit you or make things happen for you. It makes your game plan so much harder.
Envy again, coming through in a very dangerous situation. He went with the time lapse there. He was in that sentry for a moment. I was gonna say, I saw the animation coming out there, so judging from where he actually cast the roar, I think they might guess the sentry's down here. We'll see. Being an issue for them here.
He is one of the ballsiest Weaver players. He likes to really push the limits.
Yeah.
Also, not matching Sakuchi as well, it's way less of a defensive build. You know, getting the extra levels in Swarm is much more fighting orientated. You know, use that in times. Well worth it for them. Queued it up fairly well, so I popped his ult just before, gets the maximum amount of efficiency there. Nighttime kicks in, and they don't really have any big timings yet, other than the fact Lion and Timber are both level 6, so they've got all the damage they need if they want to do any rotations. Need to find the right kind of angles. It's already pretty open with the tier 1 towers being taken on both sides, so there's access to jungle on both ends.
Yeah, and speaking of timings, although Night Stalker is typically like this hero
fair,
where
it's the easiest when IO relocate. When you want to play aggressive, sometimes that really dissuades you in general, and you just go into the mentality of we're gonna sit in. And that's what the game Dusa wants. She's not pressured, she's happy.
Oh, with that mentality too, like with the IO, maybe BZZ, kind of at the point where he might want to get a couple kills, like that Yule set will be up soon if he goes for that first. If it's gonna be the item here, but the whole nighttime thing from Puppy, whereas they're maybe a little bit more passive themselves, just going for like this Bloodstone on Arteezy, not quite done yet. They will get Yol LSA comes through, but knocking me up to save is their full five heroes mid as Bubble makes the TP2, so they want the rundown on BZZ. RTZ coming in here. LSA not going to be on the mark this time. Whew! Just a little time lapse there. I'll make sure the Weaver will stay alive, but Ulti comes through from Illidan. RTZ turning his back and be able to walk this one off. Yeah, I don't think this play here. Looking for the IO, of course, go over the big burst down. Nice to play it there. Taking down the targets in the correct order here. Puppy will drop, and now Envy also in trouble as well, potentially.
I'll take that trade, though. Yeah. Puppy's slightly more value than down to it. It's forcing Booster to stay mid, not getting relocated back, and I might be able to dent this tower a bit just because they've expended like all their resources. That's still really good for them.
And Illidan into the Yasha too, so like he can put that damage right into the tower pretty heavily.
He is a shining light right now. Like, BZZ's not having a bad game by any means. I like the fact he's going Aphelins as well, but...
Oh yeah.
If Deuce is not 1,000, 2,000 ahead, the game's... That amount is relative to this game, so it's going to need to keep increasing. I'm not even sure about the level 2 ult on Deuce either. I feel like it hurts your farming speed a lot.
Oh, yeah.
He plays for hero way more often than I do, and it's going to be a comfort. The longer you can stop Weaver hitting you, it's a very good defensive mechanism, but it, again, it states to the fact they like to try and fight. They don't want to be super passive. If you want to be super passive, you have 4 in split shot already, and you have like 2 in mana shield.
Yeah, not the most common build these days. It's actually just out of tower there on a Yuln. Another ulti here from Illidan gets the 9 of tower, but actually clean anyone up here. Just be the simple pick off and then Nick's actually secret are starting to turn. RTZ low on mana though, still gonna be hard for him to finish this one off here. Doesn't have his bloodstone, so really risking any big dives quite yet. But yeah, the fact that like Aetherlands is coming out here, the full treads just tank it from BZ and you know, get off that right click attack speed and everything, I suppose, but mostly just for the tanking stats, of course. And then we also have a phase boots Weaver, which a little bit unusual in some ways. Is it just worth it for the farm speed? Just decent for the, I don't think it was really for the lane harass. I feel like the Beastmaster's already gone at that point.
I think it was, just...
Maybe the boars or something?
I can't remember how long ago it was, but Envy said this is how he plays Weaver, and I don't particularly agree with the phase boots personally, because I feel like it slows your farm speed down. It just... Your mistakes get amplified so much, and phase boots use that even more, so...
Right.
I think it works this game purely from the fact he hasn't died more than that one smoke gank, and he's gonna have his link at a reasonable time, so... That kind of makes the choice null and void. And then the only real difference will come in to, like, the 30-40 minute time where it's like, he couldn't quite get that extra attack, or he would... Oh, some shit.
Well, they're looking for a TZ, I think, so. Here. The smoke, but... Yol and BZ, they got the ward down by the camp, though they don't have this nice in-between one. Did backing away. But Illidan's got some backup here. Again, another ulti being popped off here. That nice low cooldown. I'm gonna keep him alive. Bubble gets caught in the stone form, potentially, or he's just stunned by something. It's kind of hard to tell there, but either way, Shotgun comes through on the BZZ. Violet Eyes in here with the Finger of Death as well, but coming through his Iron Man. Having the saves of the heals. LSA cutting out of RTZ while the Rogue was on the Violet Eye, and now RTZ's trying to clean himself away. Dead here from Slap Radiant. After he gets this run as well. And it looks like they can just easily clean him up here. So, summon army, Necros in tow. And Fantastic Five just completely blow this
they
game.
They have
open.
Relocate as well, they can kill Puffy.
Yeah, they're gonna go for it.
Wrong, so I think so.
And looks like no tether to bring our BZZ. Oh, he didn't have the Dragon Slave anyway, so.
That's like, see, getting slightly over cocky there, I think, because. The fight they've been taking has been going really well for them, so they probably feel like they can take fights, but... With raindrops in play, their magical burst isn't quite enough to negate the fact that Io can come in and then heal someone up. You know, if you can't burst the heroes down, they have a form of sustain. I can't remember, like, how many stick charges he had, but it was definitely enough. That was a lot of burst healing, you know. If you can keep this hero in the front lines for 2-3 spell rotations... It's hard to deal with.
Yeah, she pretty much went like 0 to 100 right there, and it looks like Iron Man probably going up towards that mechanism. Yeah, he just picks up the recipe, so does he? No, he doesn't have the headdress yet. Just still has to buy it up here, it looks like. And he'll TP out at the top lane, obviously. RTZ, nothing he can do about that. So Necro 3 done for the Beastmaster. Really opening up Roshan here. If they can get a little bit more pressure down, like they already have this great vision inside the jungle. Try and capitalize off of that, perhaps get a decent, and then
look at this sick ward though. Like getting this vision down, it scouts the fact they want to.
Yeah.
Griffey, even if they didn't smoke here, this is like. I might be completely overstating this, but that's a game-winning ward.
No, that is something
that Fantastic Five's biggest peak for a very long time, purely based on the fact Necro 3 is the strongest item in the game at this time. Nothing else will do any amount of work that this. The fact that baiting this so well, Buffy as well, that this is something a lot of teams would probably not want to do because you'd rather just sit back. But, you know, they understood the situation, now they can counterplay it, and that's purely from that ward. Otherwise, the game might snowball out of control where they get off on one hero, Rosh goes to Deucer, and then suddenly they can't fight into them.
No, I mean, that's all your towers dead pretty much at that point, right? Like, they're just gonna start the train.
That ward doing so much work, and I think wards are some of the best at doing this. They just understand what they need at certain times.
Yeah, it's not just that whole, like, level 1 and beginning of the game warding kind of meta that has gotten much better. Like, teams are just putting way more effort into studying enemy wards, too. Like, a lot of opponents will, like, look up who they're up against and say, okay, they're always using this ward at the start. Or in the mid-game, they love putting this jungle vision going on here. And well, there's that counterplay as they just easily grab Yo. I mean, he's just here. Exactly, yeah. Very exciting play for them. And Arteezy fearless without the Shadow Demon to set things up, and Beastmaster revealing himself down bottom. They're looking to be a little bit aggressive. Now they've got some great posturing on this tower. Even with the Brit, like if they brought back the Beastmaster now, it would probably be impossible to force them out of this.
I don't know if they'll be able to aggressive. Take the tower, but yeah, it's setting it off and A, denying the pressure on the other map to make space for them to continue playing this game. They've still got all their ults, so if they find pickoffs, it's all about just forcing them to play Secret Way at the moment. They're one of the better teams at doing this. They have, in my opinion, quite a counter playstyle because they play greedy. The way of Fantastic Five there to play their game, they force them to TP back to try and defend. Then they're the ones who can start dictating where the next game goes. If you split off and Pilotai finds a hero, play your one down and Secret can continue that pressure. Fantastic Five didn't make that mistake, so now they're actually taking Roche, was probably the best thing they can do. You know, they're flipping it on its head, and my point even more moot, but you know.
Yeah, Secret maybe getting punished a bit here.
They can contest the Roche that easily because they don't have Blink. The last thing they want to do is walk into the pit and have Envy get LSA'd and then burst it down. And
yeah,
Lion is not at a stage yet where he's going into that pit, and they don't really have anything except for a swarm, which again is very obvious when it comes in.
Well, speaking of Lion, see if Pilotai gets caught out here with any sort of vision. He'll run into Pasha. Do we have a Hawk available? No, no Hawk's available.
No Hawk.
Oh, they got him. Pilotai's still dead.
Base, at least. Necro's on cooldown for a while, but I think this will just result in the tier 2 going down. Oh no, Illidan backs off actually.
Don't want to give up that top tower for free, it seems. BZZ not in a position to help as he's being run down by Envy in the mid lane. And Puppy coming in, they might be able to get something here. LSA can only do so much, but oh, that silence, Envy alive. So nice play by Puppy, but actually he got the haste rune too. The roar, of course, on cooldown, so no real concern here. And he'll just kind of run his way through and check out the 22-minute rune here. Oh, an arcane. Nice. Solid timber rune.
The best of them all.
Yeah.
That rune is so broken.
I can't believe it never got changed, like, any further. I thought that it was getting dumpstered.
Well, like, DD for the longest time, biggest game change. Arcane is similar to that.
For that's
spellcasters, true. Spellcasters, obviously, but runes are meant to be powerful, so teams actually prioritize getting them. I just feel like, from a player perspective, you know Ravage has this long of a cooldown, and if you don't notice he has an arcane rune, or you just forget because a lot of shit you have to do in Dota, you can't always calculate the fact, okay, well he had an arcane rune that fight, we need to remember that, and then that means Ravage is up earlier, and it messes with how you feel as a player, which is why I think cooldown reduction awful as a Dota
player. It can tilt a lot of those like mid matchups too. Sartesi gets caught out there.
So tanky.
Not enough damage quite yet. Relocating everything brought in, he'll just north. They definitely don't have like the biggest catch quite yet. I mean, they do have the blink up on Pasha, so that's been alleviated somewhat.
Yes.
Away from like that whole just Necro Beastmaster Iron Man going for the TP here, but Pilot Eye shows time. I mean, God, he is tanky. It's a while to bring down, considering.
I think Envy just stopped hitting him, so he wasn't that tanky. He just, you know, mercy, I suppose.
Yeah, just make him wait for it.
Yeah, or just. But regardless, it's only an IO kill, and that gives a lot of information as well, because I think Envy and Pike got shown that. That kind of shows where to be, so I feel pretty comfortable to push it. They've got Necros available if they want to. Not really sure why they're not, because they see Secret pushing top, so you get the most value out of it. But if they can take the tower without it and then hold the Necro for the fight, much better than you now.
Yeah, that was a weird TP by Puppy. That.
I think that was just like, he forced him to do something. Communication on his team, maybe. But there's no way anyone there into that team. That's way too risky.
Me, yeah. Well, no Necros required, I suppose. They can find something, and Puppy running underneath that Hawk.
Playing. Yeah, just so many things. Positioning's been solid. And once he gets Axe, that's only going to get easier. He hasn't been playing like he needs it, but I think the rest of his getting to the point now where the Axe to start really manipulating any positional mistakes from Fantastic Five. Because when Hawk's in play, you never really know where it is. Playing aggressive gets so hard. Axe and Nightstalker just alleviates that problem entirely.
Obviously, yeah,
you also need a gem, but
that's definitely one thing too, like thinking about the draft and everything, where we talk about like Beastmaster and the importance of him, and then this Nightstalker just paired up with the Iron Shell, but not only so good with the silence and trying to burst down that Weaver pretty quick with the high magic nuke, it is always this classic, like, not so much this meta, but like two patches ago, that whole vision between Beastmaster and Nightstalker was kind of the tail of everything. A lot of teams becoming more comfortable with Nightstalker just as a result of that, so we always see that interesting
thing
dynamic. Yeah. Well, Iron Man. So I gotta say, I am pretty concerned with how are they gonna kill Illidan at this point. Like, you talked about him needing to be up ahead. It's very much like your Sven's, where you gotta have like a certain net worth advantage to still be a viable hero, but he has certainly achieved that with the 4k up. And like,
he's doing really well, so yeah, I think the way of killing him is ignoring him and using this vision that Puppy's gonna get in 500 gold. That's their way of dealing. Illidan's always gonna be in the front lines, so if he's pushing a tower, like take this as an example, they have this wraparound, whatever they need
yeah.
it. So then they have the Axe, when they get it, to find the backline, silence the Shadow Demon down the IO, one source of control on the Lina, and then they just have to turn their backs and ignore the stone gates.
Envy under vision. Man, that's a very early time lapse. Silence on the Illidan trying to prevent the ulti here. Arteezy coming in, it's a DD room, but it's a Timber Saw, so it doesn't really matter. And there's the turnaround. Oh, the roar doesn't come out in time. That would have been a really nice combination there from Fantastic Five, but Arteezy just getting that Timber Saw. I mean, he would have been dead, right? Like, BZZ right there. Arteezy just goes down, and that would have been huge for them. Bloodstone charges and everything, but that's the vision. I think it got fogged just from the, if that had been daytime, I'm sure Arteezy dies.
Yep. Vision is. Well, it's still like Fantastic Five come out on top there. They still take the tier 2 and finally getting to the point where she's got the two quote unquote defensive items. Now she can go whatever she feels like. I don't think Skadi's the way because she's so tanky with the Whistling Conjunction. I'd rather just see a damage item. Butterfly's also good. Both. But I could see crit, MKB, Butterfly. Get Skadi afterwards. Oh, I could even see BB if they want to play it super aggressive, but maybe that's another step away.
Is that a little too defensive at that point, is it?
Yeah, yeah, then you're basically like, okay, you can ignore me because I don't do any damage. Like, 150 damage on 4 heroes is not irrelevant at this stage of the game, but scary. They still have time to play around with their spells, and they only have to back off like 5-6 seconds later. Lina's the only hero they have to worry about for damage at the moment. And to some extent, Necrobook need to do such damage yet, but it's getting to that point where everything's starting to fall off spell-wise. Needs to start playing her role in the team, which I'm sure they're aware of.
This, I want to say this, like, Manta first build was the one that was being, like, criticized, am I right, at the Major? I can't remember either. I don't know, there was a lot of talk about Manta Medusa being hated, but maybe that was Manta before Lincoln's that I'm just forgetting, but either
it's
way.
Two very defensive items, and a lot of ways that teams counter Medusa is dealing with her before she gets online, and when you go for these two items, you do not get online until afterwards.
Yeah.
And this game is completely different because you have these items and 5k gold at 28 minutes.
Wow, she is shredding.
Yeah, she has the aura to back her up as well. She can use the damage item.
Yeah. Alba caught in the LSA. It'll be okay though. So, Emmy's in here. Still gonna get his ulti, but still level 15, which is kind of important here. We'll have to be just a little bit cautious. And Arteez. So, dropping a little bit low on the mana here for Illidan, but Ironman still having that mech. Still only a couple charges here on the stick.
They need to do have an upgrade this ward as well, on the high ground.
There's our butterfly. They really do. Well, Pilot Knight comes in. I'll be here at Spike. And there's the Finger of Death. Okay, so one done. A little bit of their control elements here. The setups for the LSA. And they're starting to move around. This is that vision play that you're looking at here. Ignoring Illidan, looking back lines. RMN, nice little relocate out. But BZZ has been abandoned.
Wow, that's some disrespect for your mid laner.
Yeah, it really was.
I think they had to there, though. Like, there's no way they win that fight. Even though Deucer gets a butterfly delivered. Secret, you know, they play around the vision game and the Fantastic Five kind of pay and they're not as five. Secret have very good chase. Like, they have the vision they need from Timbersaw and then Surge on either the Nightstalker or Lion gives them plenty of chase potential. You can get Roche off this as well, that's a huge swing of momentum. I think Illidan might be enough to deter it if he realizes it's going on because the swarm just went this way. You should know about this now. But it's always hard, nighttime, Nightstalker. You can't do anything funky here, you're just walking into vision.
Do you not? For this though, it's Radiant. I feel like the other play. I guess Poppy's doing a little bit of zoning work here, and Arteezy's still going in now. Envy heading on up. Arteezy's in there too. There's vacuum from Bulba onto two with a double manner at Spike. Nicely played by Pilot Die. So everyone around Illidan and Focus will come out. Envy trying to be the first target. Trying to drop low, Illidan doing his thing and not dropping low on the mana whatsoever. Arteezy doing what they can, but Bulba also dropping low. He might just die here to the split shot. Tries to go through the wall, but cannot find an escape pattern. Now Poppy running into BZZ, gonna slow him up, but Arteezy comes back in. Oh, it was the courier that went down. Okay.
Yeah, Shiva's delivered, so not on it, but when you say commit there, like, I think they do enough on Fantastic Five then to just slow it down so the respawn. Then they had to already be out there when they're like 10 seconds ticked over, but they were the ones starting to play aggressive, and it really bites them in the ass now because they don't need Aegis on enough on her, so they give Kena, I think, is a good decision. Very important in this fight, but giving her away here is a big mistake.
Oh, it's nice Aegis. That, not expecting them to still be hanging around, I don't think, from the side of Secret to be back in that position so quick, because Envy now looking for RMN. Oh, he will be able to survive, not getting the IO kill, but at least he's living and we'll keep that gold towards what we assume will be in MKB at this point. Does he have to be the one to try and deal with Deusa, or does it even do enough?
I feel like he needs two items at this stage. MKB is most likely the damage one, but just see how squishy he is at the moment. Have any armor, like from Aquila or anything, his space boots aren't doing anything for him except providing raw damage at this stage, so he in no way can manfight the Deusa. So MKB on its own, I don't think does.
Right.
So I'd rather see an item that allows him to scull the supports at the back and kill the sustain slash defense.
And that'll be it.
Better. Or Diffusal to get rid of Ghost Scepters, which there are actually none of, but kind of doubles as a Deucer outlet and a chasing outlet, so it's not too bad, but I don't know. He has to play really well to not have to worry about BKB in these fights, because there are just enough now for staff also on Beastmaster, meaning two ways to pop Lincolns. Lina also has Yules, so.
Yeah, Lincoln's can only do so much, right?
Mm.
Well, speaking of BKBs,
I mean, he could drop it when one of them's about to get used like a four staff and then somehow pick item and use it for the ult, right?
There you go, that's why. Oh, there's a roar in the backline on a Poppy again, playing very aggressive here, brought down by the Necros, but at the same time, it's Ironman being brought down here by Eternal Envy. a right click scan. I stay with the disruption, and now enemy being turned around after already using the time lapse posh to cut me through. He goes.
And that's why you need TKB.
Yeah.
List targets, and okay, sure. Still have the issue of you don't have damage. What I'm saying, no one item did that job for him. But to be playing with him and getting on back lines, which without Blinkon, Artesian in a position where the trees are slightly hard, not easy to get to.
Almost in a decent vacuum, but again,
no follow up.
Look who's up here. Like, not exactly much worry here from the side of Fantastic Five. Look at the man.
There's just more damage than anything else on their team, and he's still.
Yeah, it actually does. Arteezy, taking the heat here. That Laguna Blade, it's back up already. So they're gonna have to be a little bit worried here, Arteezy. Trying to keep his distance. Still level 15, but clean on 16 hit BZZ with that Agnum Step. Bubble comes in with another vacuum into the full Earth Spike and the Chakram. Alright, here's the damage of the Whirling Death. Arteezy suddenly shredding through the back line, so Beastmaster and the Shadow Demon go down. Gem on the deck. Puffy takes damage from the right clicks as well. But holy, alright, combos are real. And now into Iron Man as well. Ooh, misses the chain there from Arteezy. A bit of a whoopsie there. Yeah, he should be okay. One more chain coming through and they got him. And that's the gem. Bulba can grab that up here or someone. Jump your TP, but BZZ is the prime target now. Chakram, one more here. BZ trying to juke, but Arteezy's not even going to let him have it. LSA far back there. And so the double kill for Arteezy. That was a sick synchronization there by Bulba and Pileidai. I mean, that's what they needed, right?
Yep, that was how they hold. And that's gonna have pretty big implications on the next few fights, I feel like. But still have to look at the fact that happened, Dusa got caught in it, and she walked off and continued hitting your entire team and gave her a fox.
Yeah. Really? And maybe the positioning will be a little bit better from Fantastic Five next time, you'd think? Perhaps
yeah, I don't think
for
that's
that vacuum.
Gonna happen twice. Maybe they get it at the rope pit, where Fantastic Five is a very easy area to get big one combos, as we've seen. But just another thing I want to note as well is they dropped like two wards in the base to secure gem, so they have no vision around the map.
Yeah, I saw that too.
It's a good play to get the gem, but it's gonna bite them in the ass now that they've got like the Io and the Lina dead. I mean, their vision's not going to stay on the map that long anyway, but if you
that's
see Puffy
right?
dewarding, like, here or something, then you know where they are. Like, now you have zero information, you're on a dark map, and you have to play as five, and Illidan is your wall. You sit behind that wall, and he just continues pushing forward. That's all you do. Like, again, very all-in on him.
They have upped their damage here, though, with Arteezy now going into the Agnum Scepter, skipping over that Octarine Core that's very popular there, but definitely damage needed here. So, Illidan, he is the wall, he's in the front line, and Arteezy's gonna ignore him. He's going for the back, he's looking for Iron Man, wants that big IO. He's been dishing out so many of the heals here, but the roar comes out on Envy. They found the targets that they want there, breaking the Lincolns, and down he goes. 68 seconds, he has the buyback, he's gonna use time lapse to come back into this fight. Top of Illidan popping the ultimate now, going on towards Bulba. BZZ, he's running back into the fight, trying to use Illidan as a shield here, and it looks like it's gonna work. BZZ 11, and Illidan is going to town on Puppy. Brings it down, gets the finger of death in the back line, BZZ drops low, but again, he's just waltzing his way around Illidan, but Arteezy with that Agnum Scepter able to now get the damage to bring him down, and looking after Nine Pasha, gets him with the Tamper Chain. So they have successfully ignored Illidan and killed everyone else, but now the big beefy beast herself will be the target. And it appears that they can actually do it. Oh, that's true. It is getting a little bit low here. Bulba also weak on the side, but Envy, at least he's got the right clicks to back it all up. No mana required. And a monster kill streak for Arteezy. 3,100 gold after just picking up the Agnum Scepter, and that is the fight that they required. Great place on the map to take it for a Timbersaw as well. And not exactly great for Fantastic Five, weaving in and out of the trees. Not able to fight the vision of Puppy, of course, at nighttime, just benefiting Team Secret there.
And their positioning was ass as well, because like Illidan was down here, and the rest
he was
of the team
so
just got
far.
Yeah, they were all here, and they just, you know, they. I'm not sure if they saw Illidan, but they obviously knew he was ass. So got the jump they needed, and Arteezy. I'm not sure how much damage he did that fight. I didn't check the fight recap, but I wouldn't be surprised if he doubled everyone else's damage. At least done the most, but still. That's a really big deal. When Dusa goes scatty and now you feel you can kill her, sure, you need to kill everyone else first, but they achieved that. Now they're a step closer for it getting easier every fight. Envy's closer to whatever item he wants next. Wouldn't be surprised if he goes for another damage item. because now they've got the vision game to play around, he's probably going to feel like he can outplay and kind of rely on his team more. Also, like, full staff on Bulbous, so...
Still over mechanisms. That, even that BKB, though. Like, the only thing I would say is that, like, having to buy back during that fight, too, with that time lapse and everything.
So
I kind of like the Oh, yeah, for sure. I just kind of feel like that BKB that you mentioned earlier seems like it might still be valuable.
Envy is not a BKB lover, though. Like,
no,
he,
that's true.
He pushes the limit of how far you can wait, and he's pushing it even more. Like, that fight, the buyback worked, and the only reason they, like, killed the Deuce was because he bought back and did that. I think they still get the rest of the heroes, but without that mechanism being there, without his staying power, if he ever gets roared again, he usually changes his play, and we always look at items and judge on the fact he's playing this way, so he needs to item. Change how he plays. His team can also change how they play, so he just shine with his item pickups. But I think they realize now that someone else has fallen off. So Deuce is the main threat now. Sure, they still need to kill the line, which is what enables Deuce to be so much of a threat. But after that, the Lina's less relevant, and obviously Beastmaster's just a book and a raw. And other than that, he's auras and defense utility.
One thing is, Illidan has no TP.
Yeah, he's been playing about it lately. But, sorry.
Yeah. The Haydon right now, so I guess they have the relocate, right? But they're coming to the back lines, and you talk about Envy changing up his playstyle. That's another thing, because with his Octarine Core now up for Arteezy, thanks to that last night, he can definitely go for these weaving in and out of the trees, right? And just let Arteezy kind of be the main focus.
Perfect point. Angle as well. Their only hope is this Ward Scouts of Smoke.
Looking for it, and he's still back there. This is TP this game, you know? No Envy plays here, so. In comes Pylai, and he's still going to work here. Illidan up on the high ground. Support's very far back. Nanpasha actually going back to the base to try and deal with Envy, but it's too late. The racks are gone. So while we're watching this down bottom, Envy has successfully cleared up top.
Dead.
Yeah, he is going to go down, though. And they'll bring back the relocate, but...
They have to take this fight with a relocate. Like the Radiant do. If they can somehow get this where they have the numbers advantage. If they save their racks, they can aid. Just to come back in, though.
Yeah, this was, I think, the expected play, but Arteezy, he's on to BZZ, Puppy, he's dropping down, he'll get killed by the Medusa at the same time, they'll get Yule there with the Finger of Death, well, he's left now from the Finger, but be for long. Arteezy, nice little double Chakram plays here, a little bit flashy, as Bulba comes in trying to help get this kill into RMN, runs up with the Iron Shell, and Pylai actually gives him the Earth Spike, so a little bit of free reign here for Illidan, but it's Nanpasha who makes a little bit of an unexpected return. And we'll get Chakram down immediately, not too sure about that one. Not taking the same route as Illidan, who just wanted to get the hell out of this fight. Perhaps, maybe, hoping
save
that he's creamed his
syndrome.
Face. Yeah. We've all fallen victim to that a couple hundred times playing Dota, I'm sure.
Yeah, as a 5-position player, that was my job.
Yeah.
And now, what I was saying in the draft, where the second... You know, their lineup's not relevant outside of Deucer, start having problems. Is a team with enough mobility and enough skill and captaincy to realize how they need to take these fights. They're going to be talking about what they need to do, how to ignore the Deucer, how to hit the back lines, and Fantastic Five, it's a lot harder to kind of always be in position as opposed to capitalizing on bad positioning. You have to react to your Deucer. Like, she's definitely does damage, but it's not so much of a burst yet that you're worried about going past her. Like, Timbersaw's one tanky motherfucker, so he's fine. Envy can just Sukuchi past, and if anything bad happens, his team hopefully has his back. Or he can just take a different angle that he can get to be. Then they can just go Medusa. If she gets Rapier, that's gonna continue to happen. Maybe crit allows it, but it's Rapier territory now. She's definitely tanky enough as long as the team stays alive. And the only way they keep his team alive is a good position enough of a threat.
Yeah, needs that additional right damage. Arteezy is also up to 50 mana regen, by the way, so they need to find their own way to try and bring him down. It can't just be this like Laguna onto Envy, but at this point Laguna is just not enough of a percent of Arteezy's health to do anything, so it's basically just on like Roar and everything to Illidan like damage onto Arteezy, it seems. They haven't
That's
really committed a lot
easy.
Of control onto Arteezy, I don't feel like.
They don't have it, that's the thing. Like,
yeah.
Every time Envy's died, it's been through Raw, and maybe BZZ following it up, and then Arteezy has free roam in these fights.
Uh-huh.
Focusing on the entire game, but Arteezy is basically the exact counterpart on the other side, except he does more damage through spells, and he's tankier. Like, just straight up. At least we're full tank here. Maybe
wow, and he just finds Iron Man. Okay.
Really good start.
That is a very good start. And Illidan's kind of in the middle of all this, too. Where is the rest of the team? I mean, they're going to the Roche Pit, and what are Arteezy going to do? This is a tough call for them. They're actually going to leave. They're going to the pit. They want to see what's up. They've lost Envy, though, so their main damage dealer gone, and now the Laguna Blade as well. So they're going to lose Bald up on the high ground with the Necros. Have a little bit of priority. Yeah, we're maybe mid-fight here. So he's chasing that BCC, a big kill there, and he will get it. So now Illidan on the chase here. Nice little blink there. It looks like the safe pilot has life.
Illidan is so fucking smart, like, because they realize that this is their time. So you buy the Rapier now, and you can probably convert it to Roche, but if he buys back,
yeah,
not the best time on Zorg.
No.
I think they realize they have to contend. So with Rapier, and not sure if he can drop boots, maybe he wants to rely only on Flutter, but regardless.
I mean, I think they can't make it back in time, though.
Yeah, this is a Roche for the Aegis on and best hope is spamming her out with Dagon's now, I suppose. Like, it's a really good pickup on the Timber, but...
Yeah, this has been his build lately that he's been going for, where after the Octarine Core late game, he'll swap out and head into that, so...
You absolutely have to.
Yeah.
The only thing I don't like is that he hasn't got Blink, but that's a personal preference thing. I think he's been playing really well without it. The only time I think you really need Blink is when the fights are taken in a pace. Or you're split pushing a lot.
Look how fast he dies, though.
I mean, yeah, he has pretty much from. So it's not the biggest kill, but if they can get another kill on him when it actually matters, when they're next to the base, then he has to buy back. He doesn't have it yet. He'll probably drop by the time because he farms so quickly.
What did he drop for his Dagon? Dagon. Was it just the gem?
He had a hood.
Oh, the hood. That's what it was, right? Yeah. Typically, I've seen him ditch the Bloodstone in some games just because, you know, you get down to like 3 charges and you're like, alright, this item's dead.
Yeah,
and
you definitely don't drop it
the...
at like 28 charges.
No, no. That's why I was just trying to puzzle this one together, so. Now that makes sense. Casual hood no longer being that relevant anyway, and Illidan comes up. It fully regen melee racks, but Rapier do so.
Who
so it's
cares?
Gonna be about the same amount of right clicks at this point anyway.
Forces
here we
the
go.
Glyph out as well, so. Abarax gets gone on, they don't have at all. And Envy's no longer in split pushing position, they've come back, they realize they want to defend this. No buyback on either of their cores at the moment. TZ still needs 500, Envy's way too far away, so this is make or break here.
Yeah, Envy has dropped his TP before this fight starts, just wisely thinking about this gem too. Because they don't have one on the team right now. They have run out, so they want to get back some of this map control. And yeah, RTZ infinite mana.
Is a big thing.
There it is, Illidan walking up, and that is the Rax, so...
Really safe play.
Was that the Beastmaster Refresher, or whose was that?
Bulbas.
Oh, Bulbas Refresher.
So if they can get double back, where...
Yeah.
First back kind of baits out a few things, and then the second one is follow through from Pylodai or something, that's their best hope. I think they have to get something from this race, otherwise it's going to be the same story top. They don't have the timer on the Duda because they put the Aegis on RMM, which I think is a very smart decision because as long as he's kicking, he's been the focus of all these fights. Positioning hasn't been ideal in a lot of the jumps, but it's hard to position. I'm not giving you a flack for it, but this allows him to fly a lot easier. To execute a lot easier.
Does Envy need to go for like some sort of boost of travel play? Is that where this game is for Secret? Where there is kind of how I'm feeling. Where
no,
I mean, you already got one Rax, right? And if you had no Rax, I wouldn't say that necessarily because you just have to fight. Like, there's no point. But right now, there's enough of that pressure top that if you can crack open a second lane, it might be enough to keep you in the game.
I think right now their best play is combining Arteezy and Puffy together so Arteezy can go. Something like this, cut the waves with Puffy there to help him out. The second they have vision on Arteezy, it's going to be the focus. Most of Fantastic Five. So if he gets caught out without buyback, without Bloodstone charge, etc., it's game over. So having Puffy there to deny the vision and make him feel safe,
yeah,
probably the way to go. He's like, Bulba can obviously push out lanes with Iron Shell, and Pike can help with that to some extent, and then we can do the other wave. And then Arteezy has to continue. Fantastic Five want to push in, which is pretty much the top one. That's the lane they have their last racks in. For some reason they're not dewarding this ward, even though they have the gem.
Pilot Eye. community, so they don't know they're there, perhaps. I'm not sure, but now coming through, Illidan, and Envy has the free slot with a DD rune, hoping that he can get something onto this rapier. Okay, he actually just picked up some TBs now, but Gem on the deck, Arteezy, dropping a little bit low here. Now Balba, the big target, the man with the refresher, no chance to even use it here. And no one dead from the dark side. Now Pasha's still chasing. And now they relocate forward, but Iron Man not having anything to cancel TP, so it won't end up mattering. Get buyback from Poppy, but with the fresher picked up, and I'm sure they're fully aware on Fantastic Five that with the refresher on the decks here, it's highly unlikely that he is a buyback.
And they'll be able to figure it out very quickly. So the second they get to around this area, they're going to buyback, so he's there ready to do.
Right.
If they don't see that buyback, they're probably going to realize either they're waiting for Secret to initiate and then he buys back.
Seems unlikely without a Darkseer.
Yeah, he would have done it by now, so they should realize if they're thinking about it. And this is a really good move for Arteezy, but they have to do this. Super risky, but no way they win this. Allowed to do this and hit a throne.
Envy's not quite helping out yet. He's in that backline looking for his own moment here. Minus armor. That's good, that's good. Start.
But another disruption. Way too low now, so they have time to get their axe.
Yeah, that's gonna be Magus here by the looks of it. Illidan seemingly unkillable and unstoppable. So, although Envy's still in the back lines, well, he was, as he gets annihilated by the Laguna Blade. It's all about the buildings. It's objective gaming here, and Illidan Dota. What a rapier pickup. I mean, that was some pretty well-timed stuff, but overall, just a pretty good execution. Yeah, there were some mistakes, but overall, in terms of, like, the lack of 4 Protect 1 drafts that we see these days, it seemed like it's fairly well played here by Fantastic Five.
I feel like with more secrets brewing up, and discredit them at all, because Illidan played amazingly. Keeping his farm up, his execution in fights was good. I think his team kind of made it a lot harder for him at times, because
The positioning was weak at times, for sure.
I also don't feel like it's Beastie's fault, but his farm was not able to be like kept up to a level this game. And it didn't really end up mattering in the end, because he was basically equal to Envy, and he's still doing a lot of damage with everything he had. But I don't know, I just feel like...